Past 2 to 3 weeks, we are hearing about one of the important as well as life-threatening complications of COVID-19, which is the mucormycosis. Since the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, there have been multiple reports across the country of a very high incidence of mucormycosis among the patients with COVID-19, especially in those who were diabetic and those who have received steroids during the treatment of COVID-19. So the COVID-associated mucormycosis has been associated with high morbidity and mortality, exorbitant treatment costs, and has led to the shortage of antifungal drugs. So the severe coronavirus disease, which is COVID-19, is currently managed, especially by means of systemic glucocorticoids. So because of this reason, the opportunistic fungal infections are of concern in such patients. And while COVID-19 associated pulmonary aspergillosis is increasingly recognized, but the mucormycosis is pretty much rare. And the subjects with the diabetes mellitus and multiple risk factors, higher risk for developing this deadly disease called as mucormycosis. And the concurrent glucocorticoid therapy probably heightens the risk of mucormycosis, especially in the COVID-19 individuals. So, we have to know that when and how to suspect this condition. So, the patients with COVID-19 illness with active infection, or those who are recovering from the disease, or post-discharge individuals also. So, for all these individuals, the common presentation will be rhino-orbital-cerebral mucormycosis. So, let us discuss in detail about this condition here. So, what is the rhino-orbital-cerebral mucormycosis? So, it is the most common clinical presentation of mucormycosis, as I already mentioned, which is rhino-orbital-cerebral infection, which is presumed to start with inhalation of the spores into the paranasal sinuses of the susceptible host. And hyperglycemia, that is diabetes mellitus, usually with an associated metabolic acidosis, is considered to be the most common underlying condition for the development of mucormycosis. So initially, the patient presents with nasal blockage or congestion, and the nasal discharge will be seen in the form of bloody or brown or black, and local pain will be there, that is what is experienced by the patients. And the patient presents facial pain or numbness or swelling. Headache or orbital pain can be seen, toothache and loosening of the maxillary teeth and jaw involvement is a classical feature of this form. And in the severe form of the disease, when there is an involvement of the eye, there will be blurred or double vision with pain, and the patient experiences paresthesia, fever, skin lesion, thrombosis and necrosis is identified, that is eschar. So, the hallmarks of the spread beyond the sinuses are tissue necrosis of the palate resulting in palatal eschars, and there will be destruction of the turbinates, perinasal swelling, erythema and cyanosis of the facial skin overlying the involved sinuses, and this rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis is most commonly caused by rhizopus oryzae. And now we shall discuss about what is the pulmonary mucormycosis. So the pulmonary mucormycosis is a rapidly progressive infection that occurs mainly after the inhalation of spores into the bronchioles and alveoli. In the patients, more commonly there will be pneumonia with infarction and necrosis. And because of this, the infection can spread to the contiguous structures such as mediastinum and the heart, or disseminate hematogenously to other organs of the body. And most patients of this condition, when there is a pulmonary involvement, they will experience fever with hemoptysis that can be sometimes massive. And the most common underlying conditions have been hematologic malignancies, and the patients who are under the treatment with the glucocorticoids or deferoxamine, or maybe the patients who have undergone recent solid organ transplantation. So all these are considered to be the most common risk factors for the development of pulmonary mucormycosis. And the pulmonary infection is less common even when compared to that of rhino-orbital cerebral infection, especially in the diabetic individuals. As I already mentioned about this pulmonary mucormycosis, the patient may experience the symptomatology in the form of fever, cough, chest pain, pleural effusion, hemoptysis, and there will be worsening of the respiratory symptoms in the severe form of a disease. Especially to differentiate between the patients of mucormycosis and invasive aspergillus infection, we have to perform the test called as galactomannan as well as beta-glucan tests. And this galactomannan is a cell wall component of the aspergillus that is excreted by the fungus. And this 1,3-beta-D-glucan assay and the aspergillus galactomannan assay, and these two are mainly being used with increased frequency in the patients with suspected or having an invasive fungal infections. So the agents of mucormycosis do not share these cell wall components, and neither the test is positive in the patients with mucormycosis. So that's the reason in mucormycosis, these two tests are negative. So you have to perform the test repeatedly to get the negative results to rule out what condition it is. And whenever you get the positive test of these two, then it is assumed to be a strong evidence for excluding mucormycetes as a causative agents of infection. Because most often in COVID-19 individuals, there will be invasive aspergillosis rather than mucormycosis. That's the reason these tests are pretty much important to rule out the mucormycosis. And that is the reason recently we have the PCR-based technique, which appears to be promising for establishing the diagnosis of mucormycosis when cultures are negative. And the mucormycosis is a medical emergency. Even when clinically suspected, and the suspected patient should undergo immediately an appropriate radio imaging studies. So MRI of the paranasal sinuses with brain contrast study for rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis, and plain CT thorax for pulmonary mucormycosis. So if you perform chest X-ray and or HRCT, reverse halo sign is identified, as you can see on the picture. And there will be a thick walled cavity which need to be differentiated from the COVID-associated pulmonary aspergillosis. And you can identify multiple nodules. And in severe condition, there will be development of pleural effusion. That is what you can identify by means of imaging. And how can you treat this condition? Because this is a life-threatening condition, especially we are seeing in the hospitalized patients, a team approach is pretty much required with infectious disease specialist, with a microbiologist, histopathologist, and neurologist, ENT specialist, and we need the specialists like ophthalmologist, dentist, surgeon, and radiologist. So teamwork is pretty much required to treat this condition. Because we know that this condition is specifically seen in the patients with immunocompromised individuals, those who are with diabetes, those who are on glucocorticoids, those who are taking the treatment for the cancer. So control of diabetes and diabetic ketoacidosis is pretty much important, because which is the most important risk factor. And if the patient is still on steroids because of COVID, reduction of the steroids is pretty much recommended in these individuals with aim to discontinue rapidly. And discontinuation of other immunomodulating drugs, if patient is taking the drugs like baricitinib or tofacitinib. So now let us discuss in detail about what is the antifungal therapy which is recommended in mucormycosis patients. So first one, the most important one, what you need to remember is about liposomal amphotericin B, which is the preferred treatment of choice, we can say, in the mucormycosis. and the administered dosages will be in the form of 5 mg per kg per day. Dilute in 200% of dextrose over 2 to 3 hours infusion, and higher dose, that is 10 mg per kg per day, may be given if there is an involvement of the brain. And next, another important agent is amphotericin B deoxycholate. This amphotericin B deoxycholate is administered only if the cost and availability of the liposomal amphotericin B is an issue. And this drug is administered 1 mg per kg per day in 5% dextrose, slow infusion for 6 to 8 hours, and pre-medication may be required to avoid infusion reaction. And whenever you are treating the patient with amphotericin B, it is pretty much important for you to monitor renal function as well as the potassium level. And the patients who are intolerant to amphotericin B, in such cases, alternative agents like posaconazole or isavuconazole is administered in the form of injection or tablets. And if you talk about the posaconazole dosage in the form of tablet, 300 mg twice a day on first day, followed by 300 mg once a day. And the tablet, that is isavuconazole, if you see the dosage of this drug, 200 mg 3 times a day for 2 days, followed by 200 mg once a day. And now monitor the patients clinically with radio imaging for the response as well as disease progression, and also microbiologically also. Means you have to see the culture. And after 3 to 6 weeks of amphotericin B therapy, consolidation therapy can be done by posaconazole or isavuconazole for 3 to 6 months. So this is what is the treatment which is recommended for mucormycosis. Now, how to prevent this infection? As I already mentioned about, this is most commonly seen in immunocompromised individuals, especially if the patients are diabetes, or if the patients are taking anti-cancer drugs, or if the patients are taking anti-cancerous agents or any immunomodulating agents. As poorly controlled diabetes is the major issue. That's the reason good glycemic control during the management of COVID-19 patients is pretty much required. And systemic steroids should only be used if the patients are suffering from hypoxemia. Otherwise, systemic steroids should be stopped. And oral steroids are contraindicated in the patients if they have normal oxygen saturation on room air, which means you have to avoid steroids until or unless it is pretty much important for the patient. If systemic steroid is used, it is very important for us to check the blood sugar levels. So, blood sugar should be monitored if systemic steroids are used. And the dose and duration of the steroid therapy should be limited to dexamethasone, that is 0.1 mg per kg per day, for 5 to 10 days. And universal masking reduces exposure to mucorales. There's a reason you have to tell the patient, and also avoidance of construction sites is pretty much important. Even after the patient is discharged from the hospital after COVID-19, you have to tell all these to the patient that there's a possibility for the risk of mucormycosis if the patient is immunocompromised or if the patient is taking any other drugs related to the cancer or diabetes patient or the patient with diabetic ketoacidosis. So, during discharge of the patients, that's the reason it is very important for you to advise about the early symptoms and signs of mucormycosis that may be in the form of facial pain, nasal blockage, and excessive discharge, loosening of teeth, chest pain, or the patient may experience respiratory insufficiency. Now, there is some kind of a misinformation and misleading information what we are seeing about mucormycosis. Remember a very important point here. So, mucorales are not black fungi, and this black fungi are different category of fungi having melanin in the cell wall. And this mucormycosis is not contagious, meaning it does not spread from one person to another. And this mucormycosis is not spread by oxygenation, humidifier, and water. The fungi remain in the indoor and outdoor environment. The spores enter the respiratory tract only by means of air. So no antifungal prophylaxis is recommended as the incidence is not more than 10% in any of the COVID-19 patients. So this is what you need to know in detail about mucormycosis.